from your camera formats to optimized media, cache files, proxy files, all the way to delivery. You are working with different media files in DaVinci Resolve. You are having different settings, different codecs to work with. So in this tutorial, I want to have a deeper look at what those codecs are, how you can choose them wisely, how you are managing the related settings in DaVinci Resolve, and how you can evaluate your computer performance for the codecs that you are working with in your workflow. This is the beginning of a performance-related tutorial series in DaVinci Resolve. This will be beginner-friendly, but my goal is to dive deeper and give you a bit more background understanding how you can set up your workflows, how you can work with the different aspects that have impact on performance. So no quick fixes, no magical solutions, but a lot of content, I hope. So if that sounds good for you, let's dive in. To get started, I have here in front of me a few clips that I all created from one camera raw clip. In this case, I have used a sample clip from Blackmagic Design, a sample B-RAW clip, and I have taken this through different steps that I might use in my workflow. So the same B-RAW clip is here in two types of intermediate files, so an MXF file and a proxy file. You see very different file sizes. So this one is just 260 megabytes. The original was 1 gigabyte. Here I have something that is actually larger than the original, which can frequently happen. At the end, perhaps I am going out to make a YouTube video out of this. So I have a very, very small, just 17 megabyte encoded YouTube file, but these might appear in between in my workflow. I might take it into a more VFX type of workflow and generate EXR files. In that case, I get individual files. So you get this for EXR, also for DCP. Some raw codecs do that, where you get individual files for every frame and you have the frame number at the end. So that's quite typical. Or I may have put it in DaVinci Resolve, and Resolve can automatically create proxies or optimized media or cache files. And for optimized media or cache, if you look into your optimized media location on your disk, and I show you in a second where it is, but there you will find some cryptic folders. And if you dive deeper, you would find files which look like this. They just have a number and some DaVinci Resolve codec ending, some proprietary codec. You won't be able to open these files. But this is what DaVinci Resolve does under the hood if you are optimizing media or if you are using Resolve cache functions. So in Windows Explorer, I can't really find out much about these files except for maybe how long they are and what the file size is, but I'm not really seeing what the codecs are. So let me go into DaVinci Resolve and show you the same files there. So I have taken the same files here into DaVinci Resolve, and if I need to evaluate anything that I've created externally, what's coming from a camera or where I don't know the codec, that's probably a good way to start. If I go in the media pool, go onto the list view, then I can see the format and video codec. Now the columns may be somewhere else. You may have to scroll around a bit. I brought it like conveniently to the beginning for this tutorial. And if you don't find those columns, you can right click and enable them. So you should find the format here and the codec. One thing you notice is that the file ending doesn't always tell you what's inside the file. So if you have .mov or .mp4, there can be different things inside, and it's not 100% reliable because obviously someone could change the file ending. But here, for example, I have two different file endings, and in both cases, I have a QuickTime format inside, and both have different codecs inside. So I have a format and a codec. So let's look really at, from a very high level view, what is the difference? So when I'm looking at the file, the first layer is the format of the file. Sometimes it's referred to container or container format or wrapper. So that format or container format, that is deciding how the different types of data inside the files are organized. So you have video information, you may have audio information, you have metadata like timecode information and other stuff. So, and all of this is wrapped into a wrapper or put into a container or format in Resolve. So choose your term. And there are different formats available. So QuickTime is very popular. This media exchange format, MXF, is quite popular, especially with the Avid stuff. OpenEXR is something that happens a lot in VFX. And like MP4 is quite common, like for YouTube, Vimeo. So although QuickTime MP4 is actually, there's some overlap. This is a type of QuickTime, basically. Inside that, you have the codec for the video. I mean, you have an audio codec. I don't care about this today. But you have a video codec, and they're quite typical. You may have ProRes or DNxHR, so ProRes for Apple ProRes, which is coming from Final Cut Pro. DNxHR is like the Avid equivalent. They're quite similar. For delivery, there's something like H.264, and there are others like, for example, like B-RAW. In some cases, there's overlap, but you can have overlapping codecs within different containers, or you have the other way around, can have different containers for the same codec. If I look at this in DaVinci Resolve again, I can look at it, for example, in the delivery page where I can choose all this, right? So I can choose here QuickTime or MP4. If I select MP4, I only have H.264, H.265 available, which is fine. If I select QuickTime, I also have those available. I have also the DNxHR HD files. This is on Windows. If you're looking at the same on Mac, you would see the ProRes files. So that's a bit different what DaVinci Resolve, what Blackmagic Design has licensed for the different platforms. And of course, there are lots of others, for example, this JPEG 2000, which is used in cinema packages. So this is quite common. QuickTime is quite common. Again, MXF is also common. And then here, EXR, very common in VFX workflows. And there you have different compression formats as the choice for your codec. Now let's take even one more step back and see where those codecs are used, what it's coming from, what the typical application is. So you have codecs that are highly optimized for cameras, or that were designed for use in cameras, acquisition codecs. And nowadays, that's especially true for all the RAW codecs. So if you're using ARRI RAW or RED, even Blackmagic RAW. So these type of Canon RAW, these type of RAW codecs, they are primarily designed to capture as much sensor data as possible, like capture the technical data from the camera. They are optimized for efficient use inside the camera. That is not necessarily the same as efficient use during playback, right? Or efficient use in post-production, but they are optimized from that perspective. In case of RAW codecs, we have to keep in mind that we have two steps. There is a debayering happening, which is simply speaking, translating the camera sensor technical data into image data, and a decoding step, which is like taking compressed image data into uncompressed image data. So there are two processing steps, so to speak. And that's also the reason why the performance for these codecs in editing is not so great. So we do not have RED codecs for caching, for example. That doesn't make sense, right? So they are designed for camera. Blackmagic RAW is a little bit of an in-between thing, because there's already happening like a partial debayering in camera, and the format is a bit more optimized towards post. So the performance that you are getting when playing back Blackmagic RAW files is typically better than the equivalent codecs from ARRI or Canon. So Blackmagic Design has built like a good intermediate solution, kind of. That's why in this graphic I said moved it a little bit towards processing. But then you have codecs which were specifically designed for intermediate processing, and ProRes is a famous example, obviously, which is coming from Final Cut Pro, but has been adopted by many camera manufacturers. So originally coming from the processing idea, but many cameras can nowadays record directly into it. The Avid codecs, DNxHR, DNxHD, typically only in the intermediate processing steps. And then there are others, of course. Again, for VFX, we typically have EXR files, not normally recorded from camera, also not normally passed on, but used as an intermediate codec. Then we can look at what we are delivering. If you're delivering for YouTube or Vimeo or so, then it will be H.264, H.265. Any type of streaming most likely ends up in this kind of codec. Now, this graphic is of course incomplete. There are many more formats and there is also overlap and some cases where perhaps you are being asked to deliver a ProRes file because the studio wants it and then they encode it for final delivery. You know, that can happen, of course, or the delivery formats like H.264, H.265, they're of course also very popular in consumer cameras, especially where you just want very small file sizes on your phone and you want to share them directly without editing workflow and so on. You can use the delivery formats in editing, however, your performance may not be as good. And so there's a different level of optimization. And the main category I'm looking at here is first of all what is happening. So there's the difference between debayering and decoding. So raw formats typically need that debayering step. And then you have an additional decoding step. So that's one performance related difference between the formats. Everything needs to be decoded, of course, but in the encoding decoding process, there's also a difference whether individual frames are being encoded and decoded or multiple frames together. So in case of all the common intermediate formats that we use in processing, usually individual frames are being encoded. So it's called intra-frame encoding. That means that one frame is just internally encoded. Any compression happens within the frame, but is not related to the next or previous frame. When it comes to the streaming formats, to get even smaller file sizes, multiple frames are compressed together, but that also means that your computer needs to unwrap them together when editing, which of course is not very ideal if you're cutting and jumping around and doing all kinds of editing processing, and then Resolve would either need to cache it some way or need to always, you know, unwrap 10, 15 frames or how many frames are compressed together. So benefit, small file size, downside in processing. Now your computer may be able to do it. I'm frequently editing H.264 from these video tutorials directly in Resolve, and a good computer and not the highest resolution and so on can do it, but for more professional use it is less suitable. So let's have a look where these things come into place in Resolve. First of all, let me have a look at my preferences, the general Resolve preferences, independent of the project. There I have some decode options. And depending on what you're using, you may test some of these settings. So if you're using Blackmagic RAW, you can use your GPU to decode it, which I think typically is the right thing to do, maybe unless you have a very weak GPU and great CPU, maybe there would be a point in disabling it. Otherwise, you would probably want to have this. If you have DaVinci Resolve Studio, you have hardware acceleration for H.264, H.265. If you're using those codecs, if you're working with like cell phone video or consumer video, so this highly compressed stuff that can really help. In my case, I have an NVIDIA GPU, so I have a setting for that as well. And you can test if you don't get smooth playback, can try or can check the render times with different settings, but typically that should work fine. In case of RED codecs, there's another setting here, so you can decide whether the GPU should be used or not. Typically, if you have a good GPU, you will see an advantage when using it. When you're working with RAW codecs, the next place would be your camera RAW settings, which you have in the project settings. So if I open the project settings and go to camera RAW here, I have the different RAW profiles, and depending on what you're using, you have additional settings for the decoding. I'm not going into, you know, all the detailed decoding stuff, but purely from a performance perspective, you have the decode quality here, where you can typically choose something like quarter, half, full, and it depends on the different RAW codecs. So the naming can be slightly different. So there's, for example, also 1/8 resolution for Blackmagic RAW. So that can differ, but typically you have 2-3 options here, which means exactly what it says, which means, are you getting the full resolution back, or are you speeding up your decoding but get lower resolution? Speeding up is, of course, entirely fine if you don't need the data for the current work that you are doing, right? For editing, often we can work with, you know, speeding things up, work maybe only with quarter resolution, get the cut done, and then maybe you go for a higher resolution when you do either some pixel-related critical VFX work, like keying, for example. For keying, I always want the full resolution, whatever I can get. I don't want any proxy, lower resolution, anything, right? The same in case of grading, maybe a lower resolution is fine, but often you want the higher resolution. But of course, it can help to speed up the cut and then maybe accept the higher level for VFX work or color. So this is for your raw media when you're using that. The next would be for your intermediate processing if you're creating optimized media or proxy media, or if Resolve is creating cache files. All the options for that are also on the project level under your master settings. And if you go down a bit here, you have all of these here. I will probably dedicate a separate tutorial about differences between proxy and optimized media and all the different cache levels. There's quite a lot functionally how you can set up your cache and manage it and so on, but just from a file type perspective, you have your different options here. I'm under Windows. That's why I see the DNxHR options. If you're under Mac, you would see the ProRes options. DNxHR, ProRes are the most common ones to be used for optimized media and for cache formats. And the difference, basically, you can go from bottom to top. So you have this low bandwidth option, or in ProRes, I think it's called ProRes Proxy. Then you have SQ, HQ, HQX, 4x4, or here it's just called 444. Typically, people in ProRes, it's called 4x4, like, which refers to the color subsampling. I will not give you like all the details about each of these codecs, because quite frankly, that would be bombarding you with tables and graphs and so on. Instead, I will do two things. I give you a general idea, meaning from bottom to top, quality improves, data rate increases, file sizes increase, processing demand increases. That's the first thing to know. Second thing to know is that there are different levels of bit depth and color processing, color subsampling. I'm also not going into the fundamentals of this, but if you go to the highest level, the 4x4, then you have a 12-bit, in this case, a 12-bit codec. So this is especially important when you're coming either from log or from raw images, that you're keeping the color depth. And you're not doing any processing based on chrominance, so any subsampling. So you're keeping the full resolution. There is still compression going on for reducing the file size, but you're not throwing away color information. That's the important part about like this highest level here. Well, and for uncompressed as well. So if you need to do very detailed color judgment, or if you need to do keying and you're coming from a source codec which has that level of detail, then you want to use that level of detail also for any optimized media or caching that you may be using for that specific processing step, right? If I need to do green screen keying, I need to have the full color level. So if I have raw footage, I have difficulty processing the raw footage, I want to optimize it, I create optimized media, okay. But then I go to the highest level, so I have no loss of color information for that could be relevant to my keying when evaluating those detailed edges. And the same can be true for color grading, of course. Now, in some cases, you are coming from lower quality footage, of course, so you could be optimizing H.264. In that case, it's probably total overkill, because if the information is not there in the source, it won't magically appear just because you use a very high codec. So that doesn't make sense. Also, if you are using already ProRes in your camera, maybe you are recording in ProRes HQ, and then you want to cache effects as part of your VFX work or color work or anything, typically it doesn't make much sense to go to a higher level than what your camera recorded. Again, you don't get better information for going to a higher codec if you don't have that quality level in the source footage. What is important to know both for the ProRes and the DNxHR codecs, they are designed to have minimal losses in multiple encoding runs. That's important to know because sometimes people are very afraid of this. I often hear people who say, I have my original camera footage. I want to use exactly that same footage up to the final delivery. I don't want to touch it. I'm afraid anything may happen to that footage. I understand where that fear is coming from, but keep in mind those codecs are designed to be really high quality when encoding again with the same codec. So you could have an original camera footage, then you have to cache something like an edit transition or an effect or so. If you are using the same level of quality than in the original source or a higher level, then your impact of this process should be absolutely minimal. If you do that like 20 times in a row or so, there are some tests online where people have encoded stuff like 15, 20, 30 times. At some point, artifacts will come in and can become visible. But when you're doing this like 1, 2, 3, 4 times, it should really not be visible at all. Now, I always encourage people to actually test it, you know, test your workflow from beginning to end, see if you observe anything, but that's what these codecs are being designed for. Now, if you are a, let's say, a pixel purist and say, even numerical artifacts that I can't see, I still have to avoid them even though I can't see them, you could go to uncompressed, but of course your file sizes will become extremely large. If you do set this up properly, so from a raw format, if you go to the highest level, or from other formats, if you make sure you're not going to a lower level than your camera quality, then you could consider going directly to delivery without recomputing. So that's interesting for both for optimized media, but also for cache especially. Let's say you have a camera which is recording in ProRes HQ. You are doing some effects. Your cache is again in ProRes HQ. Then in principle, you could directly render from the cache without computing it again. That's something you can do. Again, if you are a purist and you say, no, I want to eliminate all possible risk, then you may not do this. But again, typically, there shouldn't be any visible degradation. So if shouldn't be visible is enough for you, then in the final delivery, you can go into the advanced settings and you can say here, even for the final render, you can use optimized media if you have created optimized media, or you can use proxy optimized media. Again, I will probably come up with another tutorial on this, or even render directly from the cache. If you do this, obviously, you need to make sure that your whole workflow is compatible with this. Since I'm here in the settings, there is also here force sizing to highest quality and force debayer to highest quality. That's a good setting if you have reduced the size either in the optimization or especially in the debayering here. Debayer to highest quality, I showed you the setting before. If you reduce your raw decoding for speed, not for quality, for speed, right? You do your editing, but then you want to use the original one in the final encoding. You can enforce that here, so you don't need to go back to the settings and change it. Otherwise, if you don't have this ticked, then you should definitely go back into your settings, and in case of camera raw, make sure you are on full resolution before your final delivery, right? So that for final delivery, you're using that. So to sum it up, and that's true both for the raw codec and for the intermediate optimized media render cache, etc. codecs, make sure you understand from what footage you're coming from when you're decoding. Make sure you understand, are you intentionally going to a lower level, which is completely fine for editing. You can go, for example, to low bandwidth for very fast codecs, small file sizes, and you can rush through your timeline, playback in double speed and so on if you're lucky. You can reduce the resolution, of course, optimized media resolution, same as with the debayer setting of the decoding setting of the raw footage. You can have similar ways to reduce the quality. Reduced quality, great for fast editing, but not great for seeing the most detail. If you need this for keying or color grading, then of course change the settings, maybe after your first edit, change it, update it, and then understand whether or not you had any compromise in your workflow, which you don't want to have in the final delivery, or did you work from camera to proxy cache, whatever you're using. Are you working on a level where you can trust that you can actually deliver from this, which may speed up your workflow in some cases if you can. I would encourage you to dive deeper and learn more about the codecs that you are actually using. So obviously for each of the camera raw codecs, you find a lot of information online, and usually from the manufacturers you find information about those codecs, about the different ProRes codecs if you're using those. There's an Apple white paper which has a lot of information, and there's an equivalent page for the Avid codecs which really lists you which codec has which data rate and which bit depth and so on. And there's no point in me showing that all to you and bombarding you with it. There's also no point in memorizing all of this, but when you're setting up your workflow, you can open it on the site and maybe have a look what the color compression is, what the bit depth is, and see what you actually need and what you don't need. When it comes to actual performance considerations when working with the different types, then I would always encourage a rather practical approach. I mean, I can look at data rates and I can look at specifications for hard drives and so on, right? But personally, I prefer to actually test it and see what is happening in real life on my computer. So first of all, to look at these files, if you are creating, let's say you are creating optimized media, then you can of course look at the respective folder location for your cache, or well, optimized media is in the cache folder. You can look at this and can just see what file sizes you're getting. That's maybe a first step, and that's why I showed you this optimized media folder here. So these are the files that DaVinci Resolve is creating for optimized media, and it looks the same for cache files. So the principle is the same. They are created frame by frame, which is the advantage of this is that Resolve can update individual frames without touching the whole big file. So DaVinci Resolve can very efficiently work with this. For caching, it's even more important, right? Because we have short segments which can change, the lengths can change, and so on. So that's why they are stored as individual files for each frame and not as one big file which needs to be regenerated then. So that's the advantage what Resolve is using here. Now these files, they have kind of DaVinci Resolve's own wrapper format or container format, right? So this DVCC is something only for DaVinci Resolve, but inside is the codec that you selected here in your master settings. Now, when you can look at these files, you can see the file size. So these ones here are very small. I don't remember what setting I used. So you know the size per frame, which is a good start. You know how many frames you have in a second. And if you also know how long your timelines are likely to be, or how long the clips are that you need to optimize, then you have an idea of what size you need on your hard drive, right? Now you can also check the specifications and read up like ProRes, Ultra HD, HQ, what is the data rate per second and so on, and you can get it from the specifications, but often it's much easier and faster and definitely more reliable to just see what files you are getting, see how large they are. The same of course for other media. So if you have any proxy file, for example, created, I see the file size, I know the length of the clip, I can do the math. So then I know how much space I need. The next question is my storage fast enough? And again, you can check specifications for your computer, or you can test it. And I think testing is typically more reliable. You might already have a testing tool on your computer if you have Blackmagic Desktop Video installed. That solution comes with any of the recorder cards. Like if you have a Decklink recording card, you would have desktop video, or even the monitor cards, I believe. If not, you could install it for free. You find it on the support portal from Blackmagic Design. In that desktop video solution, you find a tool called Blackmagic Disk Speed Test. And for my purposes now, that's actually all I need. There are, of course, countless of other speed test tools to measure disk speed, but this one here is very simple. If you want something more professional, of course, you find other speed test tools for free online. But this one is very simple. You say, you give a size, you select a target drive which you want to test. So let's say I want to test my S drive, which is my fastest drive. I can click Start Test. And after a short time, it's running the same test like in a cycle. It's giving me how many megabytes per second I can read and write. And this is an internal PCI Express drive, so it's very fast, so 2700 megabytes read speed, which works for all the sample codecs that are listed here. So here you see a number of codecs which are being tested. Now, these may not be the ones you're using, so maybe you're not using ProRes 422, maybe you're using the Avid codec, you're using something else, but in that case, you can still, you know, use the megabyte per second, and you know the size of your files and how many frames you have in a second, and you know whether it will work or not. This tool also shows it to you the other way around, which is also sometimes interesting to maybe calculate. So it shows you how many frames you should technically get. So depending on your codec, if I go to the highest codec, so everything here is green, right? So I can read everything, but it shows me, well, this is like excessive. I will never need these frame rates, but it will be very different if I go to a slower disk, of course. So after this step, you have a good idea whether or not your disk is a bottleneck. And nowadays, fast disks are really, really cheap. So very often the disk is no longer a bottleneck, but it could be in some case. Now, when you are thinking about drives, if you need to expand, upgrade or anything, I'm not giving specific hardware recommendations. I'm not running benchmarking of different hardware and so on. I'm not the person for that. But just as a rough guidance, think about the speed of the medium itself. So traditional HDDs are slow generally, right? And depend on the speed of the spinning. Then the SDDs are faster. But then there's also the connectivity. Right, so today I think USB 3.0 should be the starting point. If you have an internal SATA 3 connection, that's pretty much similar to USB 3.0, slightly faster maybe. But then you have Thunderbolt, or in case of internal drives, now the ones which are directly connected via PCI Express, or this M2 slots which are directly on the board, and this is like your fastest level of connectivity. Beyond drive and connectivity, of course, you can have RAIDs either internally or via external RAIDs, where you know you combine multiple disks and use speed advantages this way. Depending on your scenario and your computer, you can, you know, Google for the different performance tests and watch those people who are testing hard drives. But this should be enough to understand what you're having in your PC right now. Use typically the fastest drive you have for caching and optimized media, right? And you can have slower drives for your project media because they're typically much, much larger. What do you need to optimize? What do you need to cache? You know, if you know how long your timeline is, what kind of segments you're working. Are you doing VFX work on very short segments? Then a very small storage can already be enough to like put the highest level of quality onto it. If you're working on hours of documentary footage and need to optimize everything for some reason, things would be different, of course. Last comment on the testing, use the same connectivity in testing that you want to use in the real use case. So in case you test a USB drive, test it with the accordingly with a USB hub together, or if you are chaining something together with Thunderbolt, test it in exactly the configuration how you are using it. Sometimes there can be surprises from hardware which is not doing what it was specified to do. I have observed this, so always test it exactly the same way you want to be using it. Now you know whether or not your hard drive could be a bottleneck and whether you have any size constraints. Next thing would be to know whether your processing has any constraints or causes bottlenecks, or how heavy the processing is for the codecs that you're using. And I would again test this. For some codecs, you may find dedicated tools to test your computer for working with that codec. Like Magic Design has offered something like this for the BRAW stuff that comes with DaVinci Resolve. So if you have DaVinci Resolve installed, you also find a Blackmagic RAW speed test. And that tool looks pretty much the same as the disk speed, but it's not the same. It's quite different. It tests your CPU and GPU for Blackmagic RAW decoding, and you can run it the same way, and you see how many frames per second your CPU or your GPU would be able to handle with a certain RAW codec, and which RAW codec you have in the settings, so 4K, 6K, and then the different compression levels and so on. So you can test that. Now, you do not have such tools for every format. Maybe it's available for other camera formats as well, I'm not sure, but typically I would just put it in DaVinci Resolve and test there. So I create myself a timeline to test. One test is obviously, is the media format that you intend to use playing back smoothly in the resolution that you want to use, right? So if you create a timeline in the target resolution that you intend to be using, and you make sure that your proxy modes are off, so timeline proxy is off, and you are not using any cache or any optimized media, and then you can put the different formats into the timeline and just see what happens during playback. Actually, what I sometimes do, and what I think I have done here, is I created a timeline with a higher frame rate than I intend to be using, and perhaps also a higher resolution, so the resolution that matches the original media resolution. And then you can kind of test a bit beyond the limit. Now, that may not be a 100% scientific test, right? But it is a good idea, I feel, to see, are you just about able to play back with the codec that you're using, or is there, like, should there be a lot of buffer, right? Because later you're using other processing as well, you're starting with effects and other stuff. So I think it's a good idea to find out if your codec is really causing, like, a major impact. Is your machine struggling to just play back, or is it, like, you know, nothing to worry about, and actually the decoding is maybe not even the biggest performance factor once you start doing color and VFX stuff and other stuff. So for this, let me create a different timeline, and I can just create a new timeline and not use the project settings. Use the format that I think I will be using at maximum. So not necessarily the final delivery, but if my source footage is larger than the timeline resolution, and I want to use Fusion or other things, you know, I just want to test my computer to what level can I possibly go. I might choose a resolution that, in this case, that matches the camera or that goes beyond what I usually do. And I could just in the frame rate just, you know, put it on maximum. Now, I don't think anything will ever play back on this frame rate. I'm not sure, but I don't think Resolve is really optimized for that. But at least I can see in the playback, if I now put any file, let's put this EXR sequence, for example. Let's put that in. And I make sure that here I have show all video frames enabled, show all video frames. So now I have a timeline which is Ultra HD resolution in this case, and I have an EXR sequence. I'm displaying every frame, and if I play back, I can see here to what level the frames per second go. So, and I see that at this resolution, this EXR sequence, I can decode at around 30 frames per second. So, or Resolve can decode it at this level. Now, EXR is great for VFX, as I mentioned, but not necessarily what we use in editing. So if I use a BRAW codec, for example, which is optimized for playback in Resolve, I might get faster playback. So it's GPU accelerated, the decoding is GPU accelerated, and it's really optimized. And yeah, you see, so I get higher, like 50 frames per second from this codec. Not that I need 50 frames per second, but you know, I can find out where the threshold is and which file type is putting more or less strain on the processor. And of course, I can also check that in the task manager. So under Windows, I have my performance tab in the task manager and can see the difference between the codecs. Let me go back, play back, and open this. So I see here on the EXR sequence, okay, so there is some GPU usage actually for the EXR sequence as well, and there is CPU usage, and you know, don't expect 100%. Usually there are some bottlenecks somewhere. Oh, actually there is a bottleneck on the disk because it is not on my fastest disk I just see. So this is on the D drive, which is just a simple SSD, so I have a bottleneck from disk speed in that case. So the disk speed maxes out, there's my bottleneck. Otherwise it would probably play back faster. And now let's see about the raw media. So the Blackmagic raw files are very small files. So now my disk just dropped. So they're much, much smaller than the EXR sequence. So disk is no longer a bottleneck. CPU, not much happening, but GPU should be happening. Yeah, so GPU is used even more than in my EXR sequence. So there really the GPU acceleration is probably the threshold in that case, or the determining factor in that case. And with that, it's up to you. So find out what codecs you are using, what you're working with, maybe learn a bit more about them. Sometimes having the technical details available can be helpful, but then I encourage you again, test them, play with them, experiment, see if they are a potential bottleneck, if they are really demanding on your computer, or is it something that you know you could play at 60 frames per second, because then you go to the next step, you start VFX work, you start using multiple video streams in compositing or doing your color effects and so on, and inevitably things will slow down. And sometimes people start from the end, everything slowed down, and it's, you know, you get your 3 frames per second, whatever, and then you think, oh, should I optimize media? Well, for that, you need to know, is that actually a step which has a major impact or not? So that's why I think this type of exploration can really help down the line. Let us know in the comments if you do so, if you have any questions or especially suggestions for this tutorial series. I hope to follow up with some discussions on caching and go more detailed in that area. So subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so, and see you soon. Thanks. We'll be right back.